Now, today marks the first anniversary of the death of the beloved king of pop, Michael Jackson, one of the most influential artists of all time. He left an unforgettable imprint on pop music and culture, and joining us this morning to tell us about the Michael he knew is cosmetic surgeon and close friend of the star, Dr. Patrick Treacy. But first, let's have a quick clip of the star during the height of his career. Very sad demise for Michael Jackson, and sadly missed, and right on the brink of a huge comeback as well, and a huge comeback tour that had been booked in. Most people, of course, knew him as Jacko. A lot of people bought the album, the Thriller album, selling over 50 billion copies. You knew Michael Jackson, so how would you actually remember him at this point?
You know, there's a saying in Buddhism that there's a form of enlightenment called bodhicitta, and this is where somebody, in some ways, defers their reaching nirvana for the good of others, or in some ways to alleviate the suffering of others. And when we look at Michael, you know, this is somebody who in 1983 took the total proceeds of his victory tour and gave them to the people of Africa. In 1984, we've seen when he co-wrote We Are the World with Lionel Richie, that sold 22 million copies, one of the biggest selling things of all time, and he gave it to the starving people of Africa. He turned around in 1993 at the end of the Dangerous Tour. This was 67 concerts. It was 18 months' work, and he gave every single penny of it away again to the Heal the World Foundation, which was to the people of Africa. In 1999, you remember when he had that big tour at Alicia Keys and Slash and, of course, Maria Carey, he turned around once again and gave all that over to the Nelson Mandela Children's Fund. In, I suppose, my lifetime, and I've lived nearly half a century, there are five people I can count with one hand that would have achieved this level of enlightenment. John Lennon, Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela, Bono, probably I'd put there as well, and Michael Jackson. The difference with Michael Jackson was that, you know, as a global messenger, not only did he do what the rest of them did, but he went and involved himself in things outside this, you know, poverty, racism, and if we listen to his music today, it is just phenomenal, the goodness of
the
person.
And the breadth and reach of it. How did you meet him?
How did I meet Michael originally? Well, it's funny, Michael had sort of wanted to introduce himself through some agents. And when he met the first day, you know, sort of he came into the clinic and he put out his hand to me and he says to me, I want to thank you for helping the people of Africa. And then he turned around and he said to me, he pulled out an old, you know, sort of thing, which I don't have the actual one here, but a magazine. When I had left Iraq in 1990 and, you know, I'd been a prisoner of Saddam Hussein at a period for venturing into Kurdistan, I had wanted to work down in South Africa and didn't want to work there until after the 20th of February 1990 when Nelson Mandela had been released from jail. I made my way down through Africa and, you know, I wrote a sort of quite a long sort of thing called The Silence of the Savannah, and really what it was in many ways was watching, you know, the villages where HIV was beginning to devastate it. And this is what he read out to me. He says, later, we passed many empty villages, abandoned stores and vacant huts that are a testament to the destructive power of the plague whose path we follow. There's an eeriness about the deserted hamlets, and in the restless winds that stir the blue savanna grasses, I listen expectantly to hear the noise of barking dogs or the distant sound of children playing, and no sound comes. And he turned around and he said, you know, I cried when I read that. And then he turned around and he threw his arms around me and says, we must do something for the people of Africa together.
And it just began from there. How do you think, though, Patrick, that, like, you know, it came, that people remember the allegations, you know, the child hanging over the balcony, the serious allegations and charges that were brought against them. They don't remember all of this good stuff. Why is that?
I think in some ways that Michael was a creation of the media, and often the media didn't even want to hear the truth about Michael. Now, I'm in a situation at the moment where the media are chasing me from both America and from the UK, and in many ways they want me to, you know, put out some dirt on Michael or whatever, and you know, it doesn't really exist. And in many ways, if we even look at the trial in Santa Maria, and I was chatting to Tom Mezzano about this recently, I mean, the media were willing to pay the jurors to write, you know, sort of things that didn't even exist as well. And if you go through, you know, sort of the jurors that were involved, it really is incredible. Aphrodite Jones phoned me from New York yesterday, and Aphrodite was one of the media persons who were against it, and she wanted me to appear in a show in New York recently where she's totally convinced now that it was a total setup. I mean, what they wanted to do, of course, was hound him to death, to crucify him, to follow him in jail.
What do you think happened at the end?
With Michael?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose the theory at the moment, which is probably the truthful one, is that AEG, the company involved, may have pushed his doctor to the extent that because he wasn't turning up for performances and that they wanted to get him technically to cure his insomnia, which Michael had to an extent, and of course a lot of drugs were given to him. And now I know for a fact, and this is where Dublin will probably sit on the path to the trial, that Michael wouldn't involve himself in any of the drugs mentioned without the presence of anaesthetists. And certainly I was in Michael's house 2 days before he met the Queen.
Do you think then he actually ingested this without realising what it was? He was told this
I don't think he did himself at all.
That's absolutely
not. Oh, absolutely. You know, I mean, Michael was not the sort of person who would in any way
Do you think he put his trust in somebody and somebody abused that trust then? Or do you think he was actually asleep when he was injected?
I think we got to realise that, you know, Conrad Murray is a stalking horse here. You know, what is involved is a payout of insurance. AEG is to pay out 85 million for ticket sales alone. They pay out another 25 for merchandise. And in a lot of situations, Sony obviously have insurance things there as well. If it was proven that Michael was culpably responsible for his own death or died of natural causes,
then
it's quite possible the payout wouldn't happen. So let's not fool ourselves here. This is a $150 million lawsuit.
It's big business at stake.
In a Trojan horse of some doctor who may have killed him.
What's your happiest memory of Michael Jackson?
Ah, you know, there's many happy memories. I remember when Michael used to come into the clinic all the time. We have a big glass room in the clinic, and Michael used to fill all his pockets up with all our most expensive, you know, sort of cosmeceuticals. And I'd catch him, you know, sort of going out the door. He wasn't stealing them. He just was so rich. It was part of, you know, the way he did it, you know. And I'd sort of stop him and sort of say, OK, leave this back, leave this back, leave this back. And then one night we were sort of down in his house, and I had a nice jacket that sort of my mother had got me, and Blanket had got it and fallen asleep on a sofa and put it over himself. And I turned around and was looking for my jacket and couldn't figure out where it was, you know. And I was looking for it everywhere. And then Michael came out sheepishly where he'd taken it from the child. He says, "Sir Patrick, he takes after his father, you know."
On that note, Patrick, thank you very much for sharing those memories this morning with us.